tonight on Spotlight.
Is this filming?
Hello?
Hello?
Prince George, growing up royal.
It's all about succession.
You have to wonder if when he's standing up there on days like today and looking around going, wow, one day, this is all going to be for me.
But who is the boy behind the crown?
Oh, I love him. Cheeky chappy.
It's been one hell of a time for the world's most famous family.
Cancer had been present.
Is mummy going to be well today? Is mummy going to die?
But could this little prince make the royals great again?
It is a transformative moment for the British monarchy.
It's going to be a very different world.
Prince George, a king for the future.
It'll be very interesting to see what sort of man, husband, father, king he becomes.
Good evening, I'm Michael Usher and welcome to Spotlight. It's the royal tour we feared might never happen, but in just a few weeks, King Charles and Queen Camilla will finally be down under. And as we celebrate the man who waited decades to be a monarch, spare a thought for his grandson, 11-year-old Prince George. He's already had to grow up fast, mourning the loss of his great-grandmother, Queen Elizabeth, and his mum, Princess Kate, recovering from cancer. So is the little boy, who will be king one very distant day, made of the right stuff? Here's Sarah Greenhalgh in London.
It's a day to remember, isn't it? It's a day to remember. It's probably the worst days I can remember for this sort of ceremony.
When the news hit yesterday that she was coming,
yeah.
We're so excited.
Trooping the colour is always a royal spectacle. But this year, it was a royal celebration, not only for the King's birthday, but for a very special woman in the carriage behind.
They're on the road to recovery, a long road.
The Princess of Wales's first public appearance in 6 months.
After what has been such a challenging year for the royal family, that is so lovely to see. There's Kate with Prince George and Charlotte and Louis, all waving at the crowd. And people love it.
I think the fact that she was able to go to the Trooping of the Colour with the children was really important for her, for the nation, and for her children.
Adored as Kate is, many royal watchers today have eyes for the boy who will be king, 11-year-old Prince George.
What do you think of Prince George?
Oh, I love him. He's lovely. Cheeky chappy. Serious, though.
Standing at the shoulder of his dad, William, perhaps George is allowed to be a little serious. He is, after all, second in line to the throne, heir to a monarchy that's endured for over 1,200 years.
He's still only so young, Prince George, but you have to wonder if when he's standing up there on days like today and looking around going, wow, one day, this is all going to be for me.
Prince George is born of royalty, but born into a royal family like none before it.
Those joyous pictures. I think they're all beautiful, but the one that I think I love is where Dad and the kids are just jumping.
The Taylor Swift thing really struck me because I thought, how fun. It looked like it was Taylor Swift taking the selfie, and I imagine it's usually the other way round.
They're very much a royal family, a modern family for the 21st century.
He'll be George the Seventh, but a king in a world few of us can even imagine. So how will he do it?
It is a transformative moment for the British monarchy.
His long ascent to the throne may break traditions.
You might not be expected to serve in the military.
That go back centuries.
It would be another massive break from tradition.
He's still so young, so I think there's a lot to come.
But it begins now.
It is a slimmed-down royal family already. He's learning from the family firm.
The future of the monarchy rests on his shoulders.
It'll be very interesting to see what sort of man, husband, father, king he becomes.
Is this filming?
Hello?
Hello?
The last 9 months have been incredibly tough for us as a family. Life as you know it can change in an instant.
Prince George's path from boyhood has already seen him endure his mother's struggle with cancer.
We come on air this morning with some major breaking news.
It was a message unlike any before from the Princess of Wales.
After weeks of worry, questions and speculation about her health, Britain's Princess Kate has publicly revealed she is being treated for cancer.
This, of course, came as a huge shock. And William and I have been doing everything we can to process and manage this privately for the sake of our young family. It has taken us time to explain everything to George, Charlotte and Louis in a way that's appropriate for them and to reassure them that I'm going to be okay.
I think any family that has had to live through cancer and break that news to younger members of the family will have a pretty good idea of what is happening in that household.
I think it's fair to say that at 11, you would have some understanding and awareness of the potential, you know, threat to your parent, and that could be something that could make you feel quite insecure.
Is mummy gonna die? Is mummy gonna be well today?
The cancer journey is complex, scary, and unpredictable for everyone, especially those closest to you.
Kate's recent announcement that she's out of chemotherapy.
I enter this new phase of recovery with a renewed sense of hope and appreciation of life.
Came with a glimpse of the love and inspiration that's shaping the lives of her children, including a boy fast growing up.
Out of darkness can come light. So let that light shine bright.
The story of Prince George, future king, begins back in 2011. The world was rejoicing at the wedding of Prince William and Catherine Middleton.
It was a tough time in the late noughties with the great financial crisis. So the wedding of William and Kate in 2011, it was an amazing, happy moment.
Prince William was hugely, hugely popular. And of course, the Duchess of Cambridge, as she was then, formerly Kate Middleton, always, always hugely popular.
Then in December 2012, Kate made headlines with an announcement that would change the royals forever.
30 years after Charles and Diana posed for these pictures, William and Kate are preparing to do the same. Buckingham Palace has revealed the baby will be born at St Mary's Hospital in London, where William also came into the world. It will be a natural birth sometime next month.
It was hugely exciting because we knew that this was going to be another heir.
For the royal birth, William and Kate chose St Mary's Hospital, where Princess Diana had delivered William. It's hard to forget those scenes outside the famous Lindo Wing here, where all the royal fans and media camping out became a story in itself.
And actually what it led to was what was called the Great Kate Wait.
There must have been in excess of 100, probably 150 lenses of cameras from around the world, all waiting to get those first pictures.
Finally, after weeks of anticipation, the news the world was waiting for.
It was late afternoon when a tremor of excitement rippled through the crowd.
Happy birthday!
Kate had delivered a boy.
It is a boy. A future king has been born.
The birth of George in 2013 was fantastic.
It was a historic moment. This was the birth of a future king. He was third in line at that time after Prince Charles, William, and then himself. And I think a lot of people were very, very happy.
She looked stunning, didn't she? Looked gorgeous. 4 hours to walk out with William and baby George to the world's press.
The arrival of George meant that the succession is secure.
Viewers held their breath as the third in line to the throne was handed delicately to the second in line.
sort of this Lion King moment with the king in waiting.
The prince's official birth certificate revealed the complete name of the future king.
His full name is George Alexander Louis.
He will one day be George the Seventh, named after the beloved father of the late Queen, George the Sixth.
His middle name, Alexander, might be a nod to the late Queen because her middle name was Alexandra. And then, of course, we've got Louis as another middle name, which is one of Prince William's middle names.
Although their choice of name drew on centuries of tradition, it was soon clear that their approach to parenting was thoroughly modern.
And I think for Catherine and William, they really did go into parenting with a totally different attitude to that of Charles and Diana.
And when we saw William walk out with baby Prince George in the car seat, and I think that already showed us this new era of hands-on parenting. You know, him putting the car seat in himself.
Getting it wrong a few times before finally getting it right.
Checking the seat works okay. Nobody has done it with as many people watching him as Prince William.
Him driving his wife and his firstborn son out of the hospital himself, just already ushered in this new idea for the family.
I think it was symbolic. It was William saying, this is how we are. We're trying to be as normal as possible within the parameters of, you know, this huge institution.
The couple had always enjoyed a close relationship to Kate's parents, Carol and Michael Middleton.
In the first few months after Prince George was born, the Prince and Princess of Wales retreated to the Middletons' house in Bucklebury, where they spent the first few weeks of George's life in amongst Kate's family home with her mum and dad, getting the support that they need as first-time parents.
And I think what was lovely and what sort of set a trend was that they actually went to Kate's parents. And they decided not to let any official photographer in. The official photograph was taken by Grandfather Michael. And I think that's rather lovely because it said right away that any granddad, grandmother, would want to see their grandchild and spend time with their daughter and their son-in-law.
It was 3 months before the public got to see Prince George again. His christening was at St. James's Palace.
He was baptised with water taken from the River Jordan. That is a tradition that the royals have observed for many years.
This is a family christening, you know. Then you have Prince George wearing a replica of this kind of 18th century gown, which kind of reminds you that this is a royal baby who is going to be defender of faith, head of the Church of England.
While the holy water and christening gown were a nod to royal tradition, news cameras captured William and Kate taking a more modern approach to the rest of the ceremony.
I think this is very reflective of Catherine and William's parenting, small and intimate with family and friends.
When it comes to the godparents, it wasn't just older royals.
George has got, I think, 7 godparents looking out for him.
He only had one who was a royal family member, and that was Zara Tyndall. All of the other godparents were out of the royal family.
They've all grown up not with a royal background to them. They see life in an entirely different way. They will help him keep his feet on the ground as he grows.
In this extraordinary first, the reigning monarch is pictured alongside 3 generations of her successors.
Here was the monarch, the future monarch, the monarch's son, and the monarch's great-grandsons.
And that's the monarchy, and that's the future of the monarchy. So that really was quite symbolic, that photograph.
Coming up, the future King George bursts onto the world stage with a tour down under.
As a young child, that experience of being so visible, so loved, must be a very unusual experience. And I thought, actually, this is just their normal life.
And prepares for his future as head of state by welcoming US President Barack Obama.
Little George in his big fluffy white dressing gown, meeting the most powerful man on the planet.
Prince George was born destined to rule. He arrived to global fanfare, and preparation for the role started before he could even walk.
And then at the age of 8 months old, he was bundled up yes. and taken off to the other side of the world yes. To visit us in Australia. What are your reflections from that trip, Angela?
I think in Australia, you've got a pretty good idea of what impact that had. Can you imagine any parent taking a child to the other side of the world when they're only 8 months old? I mean, let's face it, you know, they had a nanny and they were in a private plane, so it wasn't quite like, you know, going by...
Economy on Qantas.
No, it was a bit better than that. Remember when the Queen, after she gave birth to Prince Charles and Princess Anne, when she had to go off on official royal tours, she had to leave her children behind.
It was a big tour. It was 10 days in Australia, 10 days in New Zealand before that. There was no way they were going to leave George at home.
This family is different. This family says we are, as far as possible, that you can be within a royal family, we're like you. We've got children, we've got grandparents, we want to live a life, we want to give our children as much of an ordinary upbringing as we possibly can.
To the shores of this, her southern realm, the royal barge bears Elizabeth II.
27-year-old Queen Elizabeth's tour to Australia in 1954 was 5 years in the planning and a stunning success. Charles was five, but stayed at home.
I want to tell you all how happy I am to be amongst you.
The Queen, she went to Australia and New Zealand. She was going right around the world and she was away for over 6 months. And it had been pretty grueling, I think.
It's just a different way of thinking. You left your children with them.
Kate and William are more hands-on parents than previous royals. They are following tradition in having a nanny.
I don't think there's any way you can be a princess and a full-time mother. There's just too much to do.
For George, Kate and William turn to the school that has produced many royal nannies, Norland College in Bath.
I'm just gonna walk around the creases.
Norland College is the world's foremost nanny and childcare practitioner training college.
The college where they are taught is almost like a degree course. It's a unique establishment.
And George's nanny did not come cheap.
I've come across stories of Norlanders working into six figures. That's what the family spends on them. And you expect some return for that.
For the future king's security, royal nannies are trained in everything, from driving away from danger to self-defence and life-saving.
Check her airway for breathing.
You name it, they can do it if you can afford one.
In 2014, one graduate of Norland College, Maria Barallo, was hired for a very royal role.
We know that she's been with Prince George since he was around 8 months old. So she's built a real bond with him. The fact that she's still with them, she's doing something very, very right for that family.
She She's a very, very talented woman. She's very dedicated. At the end of the day, they picked a traditional nanny for a role that could be more traditional, couldn't it?
One area that's been less traditional is education. For centuries, heirs to the throne were never sent to school. They were privately tutored. For then Princess Elizabeth and her sister Margaret during the war years, those lessons happened here at Windsor Castle. It was actually King Charles who broke tradition by being sent to boarding school at Gordonston, where he was bullied and had a miserable time.
Prince William has learned from his father's experience. He doesn't want Prince George to perhaps feel homesick or be bullied. I mean, nobody wants that for their children. And he's trying to make sure that that doesn't happen to his children.
And what was really important was, bearing in mind that when Charles first went to school, the cameras of the world were on him. When his father, when George's father, William, went to school, a barrage of cameras again followed him into his primary school. William and Kate made the decision that they did not want that to happen on George's first day at school. And in fact, the photographs of him are lovely. I mean, again, how many parents have taken a little one to school for the first time?
In a sense, having had Prince Charles grow up in quite a detached way from his parents, sent off to boarding school at a young age, and then even William and Harry being sent to boarding school at quite a young age, there's already indications that George's parents are choosing a different path, perhaps a more enlightened path about his welfare and their other children's welfare by keeping him, for example, at the school that he's at now until he's 13 before considering perhaps full boarding somewhere.
From the age of 9, the young prince has been at Lambrook School in Berkshire.
It is part of the royal estate, and they have sent their child to a school in Berkshire, which is round the corner from them. It's got 52 acres. It's a school where there are some 600 co-ed pupils. And again, all three children go to the same school, so they go to school together. They're not boarders there, they're day pupils. And there's hardly any photographs of George or the other children at school, which is absolutely right.
Possibly more important to Kate and William than education is privacy. Media intrusion into William's life has been a regular occurrence.
Things were very different when William and Harry were children. There weren't the kind of agreements in place that there are now between the royal family and the media. It was a bit more of a free-for-all.
William has been so open about his early childhood years, and perhaps that has now still had an effect on the way that he parents all of his children.
To protect George from unnecessary intrusions, a deal was struck.
There is an agreement with the press that they don't take pictures of the children when they're, you know, with their nannies, when they're out and about, when they're playing in the garden, so the kids can run around outside and have time in public and semi-public spaces without worrying about their faces ending up on the cover of the papers the next day.
One of their really smart moves to devalue any value in paparazzi shots of the children is to issue their own family snaps on big occasions like Christmas. So, generally taken by Catherine, those happy family photos have been released and published on those big occasions, but the rest of the time, the children are away from the cameras.
I think Catherine taking the majority of the photos of her family have resulted in probably a lot more intimate versions of them that we're seeing in the public sphere now, because of course when your own mother is taking the picture, it's a different energy, it's a different atmosphere. Probably they're a lot more comfortable and it's just a candid family shot.
And again, William and Kate, because I think they have discovered, I use this phrase carefully, how to play the game with the press, because William was, as a little boy, his upbringing, he still holds the press responsible for his mother's death.
Hmm.
He is no, and was no lover of the press, but he has come to terms of what is required of him as heir to the throne, of what is required of his family.
But George isn't just exposed to the mainstream press like his father and grandfather were. These days, there's also social media, memes, and satire.
Unbelievable.
One in particular, a short-lived but biting animated series called The Prince.
That HBO series, The Prince, where George was portrayed as being quite entitled and difficult for his family, what sort of impact could that have had?
Let's remember that that series lasted 6 months and then was cancelled because it was seen to be totally inappropriate and not funny. It was not funny. What impact would it have had? It was the same as having the trolls. The difficulty is that while you and I and sensible people say it was a cartoon, it's not true. It was horrendous and we didn't like it and didn't think it was funny. It's rather like The Crown. The Crown is not a drama documentary. It is a soap opera. And I think to have done that to an eight-year-old who could not answer back was wicked.
Well, that's the bell. Really fun day, guys. Text me later.
Anybody can print and share anything about you that they want in a very uncontrolled fashion. And so I think for Prince George, it is going to be a relatively unique royal upbringing as much as it's a unique upbringing for any child.
Do you think at this stage William and Kate would probably be trying to prevent his exposure to all of that?
I think if we look at some of the parenting choices that William and Kate have made, there's some pretty strong indications that they are very protective of the world around their children as much as they can be, obviously bringing them out for big events, but the rest of the time being very keen to keep them in a little bubble of childhood safety.
Coming up, George's real-life lessons are about to begin, training to become king.
I think it's an incredibly complex thing to have that weight of responsibility and royal duty on your shoulders at such a young age. I can imagine quite disconcerting.
There's no manual, there's no formal training to be a head of state, to be a king.
Second in line to the throne, Prince George needs to learn the ropes, and training, they say, can never start too young. Once monarch, he'll also be head of state and head of the Commonwealth, travelling internationally and meeting world leaders. One of his most memorable meetings to date happened way past the young prince's bedtime when he was just two.
The Obamas visited Kensington Palace to have dinner with William and Catherine and Prince Harry. And Prince George was allowed to stay up late in order to meet the then leader of the free world.
One of my absolute favourite photos of Prince George is one that I hope stays with him for his future reign, of him in a bathrobe meeting the US president at the age of two. Do you think that will be a sort of defining image?
I think it'll be one of them, yes. My feeling is that subsequently, as he grows up, and becomes aware of the political and social importance of the man that he was meeting, Barack Obama, the first black president of the United States. I mean, he's going to be able to say, when he's an older man with children of his own, I met Barack Obama.
I mean, the Obama visit was something special, I think, for everybody. It was a bit of a rock star status with Michelle Obama as well.
I think that's one of my favourite photos of George, little George in his big fluffy white dressing gown, meeting the most powerful man on the planet who was stooping down to say hello to him, a president and a future king.
But while learning how to be king, George was about to start his biggest job to date, being an older brother. In 2015, Princess Charlotte was born, and 3 years later, little Prince Louis joined the family.
I think now he's kind of got that elder brother reputation. You've got Charlotte in the middle, and she is clearly very strong-willed. And then Prince Louis, who is just hilarious and good value.
And I think it's pretty clear to see already that Charlotte, she's a little bossy boots, really. I love her. I think she's fabulous.
It looks like George is a very doting older brother to Princess Charlotte and Prince Louis, especially when we've seen them undertake engagements together, and of course, like we do when there's a significant royal engagement. So when they're smiling in the carriage, trooping the colour, or on the Buckingham Palace balcony, waving to the crowds, they seem like a really close-knit family, and I think that is a direct result of William and Catherine's hands-on way of parenting, and they're consistently putting their children first.
And again, because it's such a unique family, it's difficult because we have very little insight into what that experience is like, other than perhaps what Prince Harry has told us, that there was always an awareness of who was the heir and who was the spare. It's probably reasonable to think that that might also be something that the young family are aware of now.
And whether Charlotte and Louis have any issues with that? Or whether they just kind of accept it?
Probably too early to say at the moment, but one thing I think is quite fascinating is that you see some elements of behaviour repeating a generation. Because when William and Harry were young, we always saw William being very sort of dependable, predictable, well-behaved.
It's all a light touch, if you like. And an awful lot, I think, that George is going to be absorbing will be purely that. It'll be kind of osmosis. Mm. It'll percolate through into him by watching how his mum and dad work, by being more with his mum and dad, by having that close relationship with his sister and his brother.
There's no manual. There's no formal training to be a head of state, to be a king.
I think it was the Prince of Wales or the King now who said that he learned like a monkey would learn. You know, he was just watching his mum and dad, which is probably how it does happen, you know.
From what you've seen so far, honey, do you think Prince George might be trying to imitate or emulate his dad?
In Prince George's case, of course, rather uniquely, he's looking at his grandpa being king.
God save the king!
He's going to be aware that his dad will one day be king. And I think looking up to them and seeing a very clear sort of line of succession is probably going to be both a sense of sort of responsibility, but at the same time, probably a bit of comfort in that as well. Whereas when you think about, say, Queen Elizabeth, her early life, she wasn't expecting to be queen, so it may have come as a bit of a shock. I think it's easy for us to assume that there's a kind of overt training, royal schooling, you know, this is how to behave as the future king. But I actually think it's likely to be much more subtle and natural than that. And so there's a kind of inherent schooling in how to be royal purely from living the life.
I mean, William was 13 or 14 before he really got a close look at how his grandmother acted as monarch. When he was at Eton and the Queen was in residence at Windsor Castle, she would often ask for William to be allowed to come up for tea. One of the things she taught him was a little bit about the sort of the administrative duties of monarchy, if you like. We hear a lot about the Queen and the King's red boxes. These are the boxes filled with government papers and acts of Parliament which she has to sign off on. And they come every day. And William was given an early taste of what will, in the future, be in store for him.
That future is very different from the world the Queen knew. Yet Prince George will learn the difference between expressing an opinion and backing a cause. William and Kate address issues like mental health and homelessness, and King Charles is keen to pass on his environmental interests.
We know from Philip to Charles to William and now George, environmentalism is going to be a big theme.
Hello, David Attenborough. What animal do you think will become extinct next?
Well, let's hope there won't be any.
The King was campaigning about climate change decades before it became fashionable. One of the things I'm certain he'll want to instill in George is how precious our planet is and how we need to do all we can to preserve it.
Charles loves planting stuff. That I know for sure. And he had a vacant field on the Balmoral estate. So Charles thought, let's make a wood there. And he's named it Prince George's Wood. It may be a gentle nudge from his grandfather, the king, to get involved in environmentalism. You know, this is your wood, this is our world, and we've got to look after it.
King Charles is keeping a close eye on George, knowing that any changes to the monarchy will affect the role George inherits many years from now.
Charles, before he became king, expressed the wish for the monarchy to become more streamlined, and that is happening, and it's happening perhaps rather faster than he expected because of the disappearance of Harry and Meghan and also of Prince Andrew. I think it's possible that Prince George will be pressed into service rather sooner than he or his parents might have wished.
In January 2020, a new portrait was posted on the royal family's Instagram page, revealing this new, stripped-back look.
I think it was a real statement of intent from the royal family that this is the monarch on the throne and these are the heirs.
Monarchy is all about symbolism. And the Queen, the late Queen, understood that so well.
It gives us sort of a wonderful idea of dependability, that come what may, the House of Windsor will be there and will be there for the generations to come.
Well, you had the footage of them making the Christmas pudding and he was kind of, you know, stabbing the spoon into the pudding. It was like a sweet family moment, and I think that's what the Queen wanted to portray. Yes, I am the monarch, and yes, these are the three heirs around me, but we are a family and we do family things.
By 2022, the prince was confident enough in front of the cameras to be given more of a free rein during the Queen's Platinum Jubilee.
Prince George, during the Jubilee, was given more of a public platform than he had been previously. He was taken to more engagements and he was definitely more seen than he had been previously, and it went incredibly well. He is very natural at it.
Prince George evidently loved the Jubilee concert. He was sat next to his siblings, having a great time. The fact that he was able to sing along, despite the fact he knew so many cameras were on him, I think to us shows that he's extremely relaxed and comfortable with being in these quite pressured settings and being on the world stage.
With his little brother and sister, George attends Lambrook School in Berkshire. Soon, there'll be some decisions that might upend a few more traditions.
If George went to a co-ed school, it would be another massive break from tradition.
That will be a really interesting decision that the Waleses make. It will probably be in keeping with their philosophy around parenting, which is the closer knit, the better. And of course, co-ed allows that because of Princess Charlotte. So I think that's at the forefront of the Waleses' minds.
After school, there are, of course, more decisions to make. Will George go to university? William and Kate went to St Andrews, which might be one option. Or maybe Cambridge, where his grandfather studied.
Prince George's happiness definitely comes first and foremost. They're really keeping all options open, and no decisions have been made yet.
Coming up, will the prince follow royalty's well-trodden path into the military?
They are a military family. They have been for hundreds of years. So there is that expectation that you're going to find an interest in one part of it.
And the young prince takes on his biggest role to date.
Prince George became the youngest future king to have an official role in a coronation ever.
George's appearances at Queen Elizabeth's Platinum Jubilee gave the world a look at a happy youngster about to turn nine. But it was just 3 months later, in September 2022, that the royal family lost the woman who'd been its anchor and inspiration for more than 70 years.
Breaking news from Scotland here at Balmoral, where Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II has passed away at the age of 96.
I think that any child who gets to the age of 11, it's not uncommon for them to have experienced some kind of grief. Obviously, it's been a few years with one event after another, and that is going to take its toll on any family and any child growing up. I think that there is an added element of stress when, for example, you're attending your great-grandmother's funeral in such a public way. If we take, for example, what Harry has told us about the experience of him losing his mother, walking behind the coffin, seeing strangers grieving, that's a very unusual experience for a child. And I think it would be almost strange if that didn't leave its mark.
With the passing of Queen Elizabeth, Prince George became second in line to the throne, his destiny one step closer.
Prince George will know already that one day he will become king. He's getting used to being in the public eye. He will gradually prepare himself for the role as he goes through his teenage years.
It's all about succession. I mean, this is a family firm which has been doing the same thing for around 1,000 years.
Future monarchs make their debuts at official royal ceremonies, but there is no set age. 8 months after the Queen's passing, Prince George was more than just a witness to an unforgettable event. Thousands flocked to Westminster Abbey, hundreds of millions watched, as he took part in his grandfather's coronation. London, the world, and this reporter were united in celebration.
I say Sarah having her own balcony moment there.
It is.
There.
Sarah's having it. It's the balcony before the balcony.
Exactly.
With our very own Princess Sarah.
Hello, yes, she's got, I tell you what, she's got the wave off.
We haven't had a coronation in this country since 1953.
This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to celebrate a new monarchy and the start of a new era.
Charles was the focus of this astonishing pageant, but there, holding a corner of the royal robe, was a familiar face.
Prince George became the youngest future king to have an official role in a coronation ever. He was chosen as one of the king's 4 pages of honour.
The fact that Prince George was involved in the coronation really does make a statement.
It was very much Charles's wish that his grandson be involved.
The king wanted to usher in this new era of inclusion and of really putting family first and in the forefront of his reign.
Do you think that would have been a moment that it dawned on him, this is my destiny?
I do. And so there's all of that. I mean, he has been at the heart of something that, I mean, Charles was a little boy when he watched his mother being crowned, and, you know, I think he was about 5 or 6 at the time, standing beside his granny. He was just a little boy. But at 10, and not being an observer, but being a participant, is different. He was holding the cape of the king. And all of that will have made an impression on him.
And he also appeared on the balcony with the family. And it really was quite special, and that moment will be remembered in the history books.
As Prince George begins to prepare himself for the role of king-in-waiting, royal tradition means his family must also plan for every eventuality.
If anything were to happen to Charles as king and to William as the heir apparent, formally, George could not become king until he reaches the age of 18. If George were not old enough himself to become king, that would trigger a regency.
But that scenario is thankfully highly unlikely. Whenever Prince George does eventually take the throne, he will also become Commander-in-Chief of Britain's armed forces. It's a royal tradition going back centuries.
It's important that the monarch commands the armed forces. Respect. So future monarchs have had military training. Prince Charles was in the Navy. Prince William was trained as a helicopter pilot and worked in air rescue.
It gives them a sense of discipline. It gives them a sense of egalitarianism. When they're in the army, they're Lieutenant Wales or Captain Wales. They're not a general, so they have to sort of salute and obey the rank, which I think is very important, so they don't get above themselves.
It is still early days, and there are rumours that when the time comes, George may choose to break the royal mould.
It actually has been reported that they might break with centuries of tradition and he might not be expected to serve in the military before becoming king. This would be a significant break, but no decisions have been made.
The reign of King George is likely many decades away, but it's clear the monarchy he'll inherit is being transformed.
Charles is trying to manage the monarchy from a monarchy that was really founded on empire into one where we're now just a small island country and we have to adjust our expectations. And by the time George becomes king, the monarchy will be very different. It'll be much more like the monarchies on mainland Europe.
I think it's absolutely undoubted that Prince George, when he grows up, when he becomes king, is going to be very different from the generations that have gone before. We've seen that with every monarch, actually, that they bring their own unique style, their own passions to the job. And who knows what he's going to be like? It could be 60 years before Prince George becomes king. He might be flying to his coronation in a flying carriage. Who knows? It's going to be a very different world, but ultimately he will have grown up in that world and will therefore bring to the modern world a modern upbringing that he's had.
It's possible that William will live until he's 90, which means George will be 60 before he comes to the throne. And in all that time, he has to absorb what his ancestors, what his family are doing as royals, learning the job. That's what he's going to do. Mm. And by the time he becomes king, he will probably be married. He will have children. He will have had a proper education, and he will have grown up in a world that is developing alongside him as he gradually understands the importance, the duty of his role.
As he's growing up and he learns more about the world, I think we'll be able to see some more glimpses of what his personality is like.
He's obviously in a very warm family environment, but, you know, eyes wide open. He knows what's coming and, you know, he's learning from the family firm.
Prince George is really coming to his own. He's definitely becoming more confident the more public engagements he does. He's still so young, so I think, yeah, there's a lot to come.